Hello and welcome to our second episode of Access Heritage. Nothing brings back memories of childhood quite like the taste of a favourite sweet, the sugary coating, the sweet and sour taste of rhubarb and custard, pear drops or licking kali off a lolly. Today we are delving into the history of sweet making inside T. Cook's sweet shop.
Hello and welcome to Sugar Plums and Sherbet. My name's Jean and I'm going to tell you a little bit about Black Country sweet making. In the Black Country, we don't call our sweet shops, we call them suk shops. Now, suk is the word for sweets in Black Country dialect because children in Victorian times would suck on the hard-boiled sweets that were made. Then, because they didn't have a lot of money, they would then save that sweet for another day. And shop is shop. So suk shop is the sweets that the children would have enjoyed, albeit just for a very short amount of time. Sweet making in the Black Country was mainly, in Victorian times, the hard-boiled sweets. And to make the hard-boiled sweets, you would firstly need a copper pan. The man was usually the one who did the sweet making, and the woman would sell the sweets. But the man would start by putting in sugar, followed by glucose, and then he would boil that up to a temperature of 300 degrees Fahrenheit, or about 150 Celsius these days. And in the copper pan, which was extremely heavy, he would wait and wait until it bubbled up, until it got almost to the surface. When it reached that temperature, he would pour it out onto a heated table. That kept the mixture warm while he added the things to make them into sweets. Colours in Victorian times were not the best. In fact, a doctor wrote in the Lancet in late Victorian times that he did not approve of the use of certain things or poisons within the sweet making realm. For red, they started by using red lead. Red lead, of course, is extremely dangerous. Following that, for red, they used this. This is cochineal. And cochineal is squashed beetle's blood. There we have it. At this point, you would groan, you would think, oh no, how can they do it? But yes, that's what they used. For blue, it would be mercury, extremely dangerous again. One of the worst colours of all would be green. Green sweets were made with arsenic poison. Flavours in Victorian times in the Black Country would have been mainly what was grown in the local gardens. One of the most popular sweets of the time, and is actually quite popular today, is dandelion and burdock. Very popular. There are other things you can think of right away, such as mint. They would use mint from the garden. But locally grown flowers, such as coltsfoot, hoarhound, all those are very popular sweets at that time.
From the 1800s, this was the dawn of a new era for confectionery manufacturers, assisted by the rise of the Industrial Revolution and mass production. British sugar beet became more commonly used than costly sugarcane, which had to be imported. The cost of setting up confectionery businesses was relatively inexpensive and could even be set up in the backyard at home. Sweets were now not only a luxury for the rich, but available for the working classes too. An average of 33 bags of sugar was eaten per person in Britain by the 1900s. Soldiers in the First World War were said to have had very poor teeth because of this.
The sweetmaker would use a drop roller machine, such as the one we have here, and choose the rollers for the shape of sweet that he wanted. The drop rollers themselves, the ones that we have here that you can see, were made in Rochdale by a firm called Luke Collier and Son in early Victorian times, from around 1835. And they are brass, he was a brass founder. And two of these would fit onto the machine, such as the one here we have set up. And the mix, then the small amounts that he put into small balls, would go onto this side of the drop roller. He would turn the handle. The mix would go through while it was still hot, because the mix must be hot, otherwise the sweet making doesn't work because it would be too brittle. The shape on the roller is pushed into the hot sugar. It comes out in a strip, which is then placed on the surface here and allowed to cool for about 5 minutes. Once the sweets have gone hard, it takes about 4 to 5 minutes, you would drop them into this, which is a riddle. It's an old-fashioned sieve, and my father regularly asked me to do his garden soil with one of these. So the sweets would go into here, shake off the excess so that you only have the sweet shape in there, and then for about 30 seconds they're put over steam, and that allows us to cover the sweets in sugar so that they don't stick together. And that was the last part of the sweet making. Once that was done, they would then have the sweets ready for sale. Hello, you don't see bags like this very often, do you? This is a cone-shaped brown greaseproof paper bag. Do you hear it? And in that, in the early part of the 20th century and late Victorian times, they would put 3, 4, 5 small sweets. They would fold the bag over, and that was a treat for children. That was called a penny twist, and there it is. Children generally in the Black Country didn't have much money, so when they wanted a sweet, they knew that if they went to Mr. Cook's store, knocked on it and said, "Hello, can we help you today?" that if they got some work from Mr. Cook, their reward would be 2 or 3 nice small boiled sweets that he'd made, which they would suck and save. So that was the way children managed to get sweets in Victorian times in this area.
We do hope this hasn't put you off your sweets and has given you some interesting stories to get your teeth into. Thank you for joining us. We'll post a new film in this series every month in place of our specialist tour. To stay up to date with our content, please visit Black Country Living Museum's YouTube channel, where you can like and subscribe. Or you can even visit our website at bclm.com/access for more information.